This segment of our program is proudly sponsored by STEM City USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, two organizations dedicated to fostering innovation and promoting excellence in STEM fields. At STEM City USA, they believe that there is an inventor, a scientist, a dreamer in all of us waiting to be discovered. They're committed to inspiring and empowering our youth by providing a platform where they can explore their interests in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Their mission is to create a world where every young mind is nurtured and their dreams are not just encouraged, but made possible. In conjunction with the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, they're honoring the best and brightest in the engineering field. This conference is a testament to the incredible talent and groundbreaking contributions made by Black engineers. It stands as a beacon of hope and a source of inspiration for future generations of engineers. Visit us at STEM City USA and become everything you are. Discover your potential, unlock your creativity, and let's shape the future together. Because at STEM City USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, we believe in you. Stay tuned for more of The Larry Young Show.
Oh, what a lovely, precious dream
to be young, gifted, and fine.
Open your heart to what I mean.
Good morning, good morning. You're listening to LY Morning Podcast Show. LY Morning Podcast Show on Wednesdays. And it was right now looking at the time of 10 to 11:30. That's being discussed, but for right now, that's the time for you to lock in. I'm very happy to say that we've obtained a sponsor for the month of April. So we know we'll be in place. Thank you, thank you, thank you for that. And that's the fantastic company of Career Communications. Career Communications. And Corporation. STEM. The STEM organization. STEM USA has agreed to be a sponsor, and they are, and we're very, very happy to have them as such. Also, we're going to have a loaded program in terms of some information. And let me get Mr. Brother Mark C. up. Brother Mark.
Hey, how y'all doing, guys?
Hey.
Good morning.
Well, I'll be honest with you, partner. I had intentions of getting with you yesterday, but I spent most of my early evening at Patient First. And it was difficult, but they finally were able to find something to help me with my hiccups, because I had gone through the whole day, and you talk about nerve-wracking. Oh my goodness. But I got to give it to him. I told him I was going to give him a shout out. I went to two doctors, and they tried to give me some stuff, and it worked for a temporary time. But this guy at Patient First, he went to work. And within 2.5 hours, he was able to find some contraption he mixed together, told me to take it, And within 15 minutes, I was walking out of there, as I am, thankfully, prayerfully, right now, able to talk without hiccups. So, I'm just so very grateful to them for their patience with me. Because, I mean, I was in there. I was frustrated as heck. But anyway, thank you, Patient First. You got yourself an advocate. I've been going to Patient First over the years, but this time was, like, exceptional. And That's how I spent my Tuesday evening. But thankfully, I was able to leave a much more satisfied customer. And Biggie, Mr. Punctual, always on the clock.
I'm trying to be.
And he arrived as he usually does, going through some severe car problems. And if you got any decent car, second cars you want to talk about, Biggie would be interested in listening to you.
Mm-hmm, I sure will. Need some wheels. Look, I need some wheels right now, yo.
Yeah.
Help me out.
Yes, indeed. So
something cheap, too.
He's very, very, very good at being punctual as heck. And even now, no car. He shows up whatever the stated time is.
I tried.
That's the time.
I tried. You know.
So thank you.
Appreciate you. Thank you, bro.
All's good. So, Mark, how you doing, soldier?
You know, I'm hanging in there, man. You know, my heart's heavy, just like everybody else. But let me say this first, man. I wanna give a shout out to the mayor. You know, our governor. You know, and Johnny O, and just, you know, all of, you know, our leaders, you know, that were there early morning yesterday, and the governor right there, you know, and in the morning, the mayor's right, you know, right there, 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, whatever it was, Johnny O, and our leaders, man, for this tragedy, you know, and yesterday I just listened, you know, to shows, Larry, and you were telling them, you know, and I listened to you, man. You're such of a, you know, not only just a professional, man, you're a soldier, man, because, you know, I just listened to shows yesterday. I listened to Lunch with Labor, watched the news, and when I saw it, I couldn't believe it. When I saw the bridge collapse, I get up early, just like you. I got up, you know, decades. Like 4:30 in the morning to go to work at VA before I retired, and so I get up early and I'm watching and I see the bridge collapse, and I was in shock just like I was with 9/11. 9/11, I was working at VA, and we heard. I was in my area and we heard about the first plane, and everybody, you know, left out their areas and went to areas where TVs was, and I literally saw the second plane hit. And that's how I felt. You know, it came back when I saw the bridge collapse, you know, and then I heard it was 8, you know, people that was working on that bridge, and they, you know, they only found 2 of them. One of them miraculously, guys, didn't even need any medical help, you know, but the other 6, you know, me and my wife, we was watching the news yesterday, and, you know, we kind of knew, you know, that when they hadn't found those 6 since about 1:30 in the morning or 2 o'clock in the morning, that, you know, it was going to turn into a search and recovery. Condolences, man, go out to all of the victims, you know, and their families and things like that, man. This is, again, one of those things, you know, living in Baltimore that you never, ever, ever think will happen, man. But it did, right? And the president, shout out to him, man. His statement was, we with you, man. He's going to foot the cost of the, you know, replacing the bridge. And just, you know, hearts go out to the family, man.
Yeah. I was noticing this morning that the emergency room doctors revealed that the Baltimore bridge victims' traffic fight for survival, shock, hypothermia, exhaustion, plus a 185-foot drop would have felt like hitting concrete.
God damn.
Wow.
Yeah, the ER doctors fear that nearly 2 dozen people who plunged 185 feet from the Baltimore Bridge last night may not survive, as they revealed their biological race against time. Around 1:30 a.m. on Tuesday, the Singapore-flagged cargo ship Della crashed into the Francis Scott Key Bridge, launching at 20 people into the cold water of the Patapsco River. These included six construction workers who were on the foot on the bridge and people in five cars. Two people have been saved so far, while another is in critical condition, officials announced. Tragically, doctors told DailyMail.com that those on foot faced an agonizing drop from what would feel like hitting concrete and result in major injuries like broken bones and a ruptured heart and a small chance of survival. Once in the 47 degree water, the causing hyperventilating, loss of motor control, confusion, organ failure, starting in just 3 minutes. And those in cars would have just 2 minutes to escape from their cars before drowning. Hypothermia is a medical emergency that occurs when the body loses heat faster than it can reproduce it. A normal human temperature is generally considered 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit, though it can range from 97 to 99. However, exposure to cold air or water can cause body temperature to gradually drop. A temperature of 95 Fahrenheit or less is considered hypothermia. Whew. Yeah. Dr. Darren Ross, emergency medicine physician, told the Daily Mail, at these water temperatures, without protective clothing, such as an immersion suit or dry suit, we would expect the effects of hypothermia to set in quickly. Dr. Ross estimated that in just 3 to 5 minutes, a person with hypothermia may suffer impaired motor skills or clumsiness. Exhaustion can occur within 30 to 60 minutes for loss of consciousness expected by the end of the first hour, he said. So Dr. Ross noted that someone with flotation and access to fresh air can breathe, could survive up to 3 hours. Those without it can suffer deadly organ failure in about an hour. In about 3 to 5 minutes, a heart rate and blood pressure drop as a person is too cold to pump normal blood flow into their body. Result of not getting enough blood, oxygen, nutrients around the body is nerve damaging and can set in after as little as 20 minutes. Nerves start to die, which can lead to a patient to think they are burning up rather than freezing, causing them to strip off their clothing. After 30 to 60 minutes, a person may lose consciousness. Organs like the heart, lungs, and brain start to shut down. Several factors can impact how long a person can survive hypothermia. Dr. Luan Gengagotsko, medical medicine physician and chief medical officer of the American Family Care, told Daily Mail that children in particular may have advantage because they have a higher body surface area than adults, which allows the body to better maintain core temperatures. This may allow a child to survive up to 1 hour when submerged in water, cold water, less than 40 Fahrenheit. It's unclear if any children were involved in the bridge collapse in Baltimore. The doctor also noted that individuals who are more physically fit may survive longer due to their bodies being able to adjust to harsher conditions faster. While trending water can greatly extend survival in warm water, in cold water, exhaustion will set up in quickly, and swimming ability will not sufficiently increase survival. A person's weight can also determine how fast they succumb to hypothermia. Researchers have found, for example, that those with vesicle fat can lies deep within the abnormal wall, can maintain a normal core temperature longer than those with lower levels of it. However, subconscious fat, which is just underneath the skin, does not have the same effect. For those standing on the bridge, such as construction workers, the doctor said that she would expect them to survive, not to survive, just the plumbing down 185 feet. This is due to the high speed at which a person falls, also known as velocity, and hits the water. According to the Federal Aviation Administration, the maximum rate of someone can survive a fall into water is about 100 feet per second. This is equivalent of 186 feet. With the bridge being about 185 feet above the water, this is at the upper limit of survivability for a fall. Falls from this height can cause severe blunt trauma, especially when the person lands on their chest or abdomen. Whew. They tell me that the ship that hit the bridge was as long as the Empire State Building. Mm. Was that long?
Tons. I know it was heavy. All that stuff on there. But I didn't know that fall was that high. That really put it in perspective. 185 feet. Yeah, you lucky to live just from that fall alone. And even if you know how to fall or trying to fall the right way, you can die from that one. So it was sad, man. It was sad. But while you on that, you want me to play that little clip from Brandon Scott?
Thank you. Would you
Brandon Scott, how he handled it. Yeah, I did like how he jumped on it, though. They jumped on it early. They got out there. Coast Guard, everybody got in there early and did what they can do in a bad situation. So I'm just play how he handled it. He handled a couple media, a couple reporters, you know, asking about, you know, what was going on.
How long is it going to take to rebuild this land?
I think right now, sir, listen, we shouldn't even be having that discussion right now. The discussion right now should be about the people. The discussion right now should be about the people, the souls, the lives that we're trying to save. There will be a time to discuss about a bridge and how we get a bridge back up. But right now, there are people in the water that we have to get out. And that's the only thing we should be talking about.
To go back, how long is it going to take to
Yeah, that basically replayed it, but yeah, he definitely, yeah, Brandon Scott, he handled that, he jumped on that one real, you know what I mean, sufficient on this one. I gotta say I'm with him on this one, because, yeah, forget the 15 million, we're gonna lose a day and all that, it's lives, like, them people was working to better the bridge, so everybody can, you know, get back and forth, and the economy can be, you know, up to par, but just imagine, you at work, in the middle of the night, trying to, you know, make as less ripples as possible, so everybody can still flow traffic, and then something like that happens. So, yeah, I feel for the people. And like you say, it's up to about 20 people now. I just, that's another, you know, update for me because I thought it was still at the 8. So it's even worse. And like I said, look, the Mayday call and everything they did, the jump in front of it, it saved a lot of lives too because that bridge at 130 still got traffic coming through there. Like as you can see, if you watch the videos, it's still cars coming through there. So everybody did their part, you know, as far as jumping ahead of it and trying to save what they could, but it's just unbelievable, man. Like you say, 9/11 is you'll remember where you was at when this happened too. This one of them times. So, it is what it is. But you know, we strong. We'll bounce back. We'll bounce back.
We must absolutely. Gotcha. We must. I thought that the governor,
everybody,
yesterday the mayor, Van Hollen's office, Johnny Oszewski, the county exec from Baldwin County. All of the major players were there.
Right.
1:30, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock. And most of them even stayed.
Yep. Department of Transportation. Everybody stepped up.
Until the late morning, if not longer. I had no idea that one bridge right there would be such a major national effect. I mean, you turn on the national news, it made national news. You know, leading story in some cases. Mm-hmm. I'm an MSNBC listener. And
faithful.
Yes, yes.
Faithful.
Biggie says faithful. But that's true. That's true. Mm-hmm. That's true. And but anyway, they, top story. Mm-hmm. You know, all day yesterday and this morning. Mm-hmm. And, oh, my goodness.
Look, I hate that we made the news for that, but it's like, yeah, hopefully something good can come out of this black cloud because, yeah, the port is big. Like you said, that's the number one transport out of the mid-sized cars, and I think they said the SUVs or something like that. We number one, number two in another cap. So, yeah, the port being shut down is going to affect the whole, you know, the whole region. So we got to get it rolling. Like I say, look, we got to, like Brandon said, worry about these people and worry about their families first, and then we're going to get the bridge second. So. You got to be a human first. We got, you know, we lost lives and people died trying to, you know, work basically. So we're going to get that part done. Then we'll worry about the bridge probably next week or a week or two from now. But it'll be back open. Trust me. Like we say, we strong, we resilient. And they can't
and
hold us
down. And the president said he's going to
pay it all.
Pay the bill.
Yep.
And so one of the reporters turned to him and said, well, what about the company that had the ship that broke down? And he said, that process will have to come in place. We'll deal with that. Mm-hmm. But right now, let's find out what it costs to get it done and just go ahead and get it done.
And we'll get the money back on the back end if we need to, if they're at fault.
And, you know. And believe you me, Uncle Sam will get that money.
Oh, yeah,
back.
Oh, yeah. He ain't going to play with him. Or you won't be coming through with no more, but you won't make no more money coming through this port. So.
Or any other port.
Mm-hmm. In the world.
So, Mark?
Yeah, so the crew, all of the crew was able to get off. And Larry, you said something that I wasn't quite clear about because they were talking about the workers, the guys, you know, that were working for the construction company and doing filling the potholes. And I can't even imagine, man. They wasn't even in cars, you know.
Exactly.
The cars, the people that was in cars, Larry, so are you saying that they perished too? Or?
That's what they're predicting. Yes, sir.
Wow. So, the governor, you know, he said that Secretary Buttigieg, he said when he came yesterday, he said he was there all the time, you know, the federal government is going to make sure that Baltimore has, and the mayor said the same thing, that they're going to make sure Baltimore has everything that they need. And, you know, the governor and Buttigieg, both of them are military men. So the governor was a leader of men, you know, in Afghanistan, and I think both of them. So, you know, they know about, you know, tragedies and stuff like this. But that's what he said. That's what the governor said. You know, he gave kudos to Buttigieg and the president. You know, the president just said, I'm here. But as far as the port, they were saying that they're going to lose I think it's like 15,000 employees. They're going to lose like $9 million a day. You know, so it's, you know, not only are we still recovering, you know, these bodies and stuff like that, but, you know, the port is shut down, and so, like I said, again, like $9 million a day, like 15,000 employees. And we got to give a shout-out to Mount Olive Church because they had a event over there yesterday for the families and stuff like that, and Van Hollen and the mayor, and I think Johnny O and other people were over there. So, you know, to let the families know, man, that they you know, we here for them. Mm-hmm. So we got to shout them out. I'm on Mount Olive Life.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And they look, Mark, and look, on the paper today, I say up to 15. So it's probably between 10 and 15 million a day. But yeah, look, you know what would be nice? Maybe down the line, if we could meet one of them or try to interview one of them, that's a survivor that did, because I want to know I want to meet him or see, you know, how did he survive this? Because this is crazy. Like, the fall and have no injuries? I don't know how he did it, but I would like to meet him and talk to him, at least see an interview from somebody to get him on, you know. This is definitely this is a life-changing event for the whole city, everybody, the whole world.
So one of the workers' wives spoke out.
Okay.
He had just started He had just started with that construction company. Most of them was from Honduras and Guatemala and Mexico, and just came here to make a better life for their family.
Right.
Never coming home again. So you just don't know. Yesterday, like I said, I just listened, to a different program. Times we had our grandson, so I just, turned stuff off, at times, man. And just listen to you and Coach and other programs, just to, see what was, being said, and the mayor, the governor, and everybody. And, this was, a good thing. Like Big E said, it was, at least it was a warning.
Mm-hmm.
So that more people,
right,
didn't die. But, this is something, man. This is one of those. And Larry, what do you think, man? I mean, you've been in Baltimore all your life, man.
Tragic. This is absolute tragic, partner. I mean, I was floored yesterday morning. When, as you say, we get up early, we turn it on, and at first I said, gee, Merry Christmas, what happened here? Mm-hmm. And then when I heard about the bridge had fell down, I thought maybe something, but I didn't expect to find out, though, the bridge literally collapsed.
Fell in the wood, right. Did y'all go to terrorists when y'all first heard it? Because my first instinct was to think about a terrorist. My first mind was thinking 9/11. That's the first thing that hit me. I'm like, oh, my God. I hope they're not really hitting Baltimore right now, shutting down the port and then doing this and doing that. But my first train of thought went, okay, is this terrorist? But then I found out, it was a Mayday call and all this. So it made more sense once I got more information. But, yeah. Did y'all think it was terrorists when you first heard it? Just tell the truth.
No.
You didn't think so?
I didn't think so.
How about you, Mark?
No, I didn't, because, I didn't know what had happened at first.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw the bridge collapse, and then they start talking about the cargo ship running into it,
mm-hmm.
And Larry, I don't know how true this is. Maybe you know more about this than I do. They were saying that the ship was having problems before. Did you hear anything about that?
No, I did not.
Yeah, so they were saying, that maybe the ship shouldn't even have left, the investigation is going to go on. And I think it was just, an unfortunate, tragic, accident. And, Marjorie Taylor Greene, from the crazy caucus, that got kicked out of the crazy caucus, she, came out and, saying, is it, did it happen on purpose and this, that, and the other.
Wait a minute. She even commented on this?
Yeah, I sent it to you. David Simon, who was a reporter here for The Sun and the founder of the Homicide, Life on the Street, and The Wire, he came. I sent it to you, Larry. He came out and, chastised her, for coming out. But I don't expect, any left, from heartless people like her. And,
some people do stuff for the shock factor.
The crazy caucus,
Mm-hmm.
Her and Jim Jordan and heartless people like that. Years ago, Big E, mm-hmm. It was a infrastructure bill years ago when President Barack Obama was the president, and people like Jim Jordan and them, they were against, and that's what the bill was for, jobs and we had the Jobs and Justice rally, Larry and them. That's when I first really met Larry, and the National Anthem Network did a free trip to D.C., and that's when Mitch McConnell said that they were going to do everything that they could to make him a one-term president, including not passing that job and infrastructure bill for bridges and roads and all that. That was way back in 2011. But President Biden was able to get one passed and send millions of dollars here for things like that. Am I right, Larry?
You're right.
It's... You know, I expect, you know, I expect nothing less from heartless people like that, man. Mm-hmm. You know, and whenever you're ready, man, I sent you also. You know, I've been talking about that Donald Trump said that he ran as a Republican because their voters are more stupid. And Jared Kushner, he was the one that I think he worked at a paper or something, but the lady, he told the lady, he said, Donald Trump don't really believe the stuff he be saying about the birth and all that. You know, he said he was going to run as a Republican because he believed the poor white and working class voters were stupider. And he said that. And what I did, guys, I pulled it up. And it says, Jared Kushner admitted Donald Trump lies to his base because he thinks they're stupid.
Hold tight. Hold that point right there. Hold that yes, point sir. Right there, mm-hmm, buddy. Mm-hmm. We're going to take a little break, and we're going to come right back. I want to make sure that this statement you're about to talk about is heard loud and clear. Mm-hmm. Hold tight.
I thought you would.
This segment of our program is proudly sponsored by STEMCITY USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, two organizations dedicated to fostering innovation and promoting excellence in STEM fields. At STEMCITY USA, they believe that there is an inventor, a scientist, a dreamer in all of us waiting to be discovered. They're committed to inspiring and empowering our youth by providing a platform where they can explore their interests in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Their mission is to create a world where every young mind is nurtured and their dreams are not just encouraged, but made possible. In conjunction with the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, they're honoring the best and brightest in the engineering field. This conference is a testament to the incredible talent and groundbreaking contributions made by Black engineers. It stands as a beacon of hope and a source of inspiration for future generations of engineers. Visit us at STEMCITY USA and become everything you are. Discover your potential, unlock your creativity, and let's shape the future together. Because at STEMCITY USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, we believe in you. Stay tuned for more of The Larry Young Show.
Hi, I'm Larry Young.
And this is In Conversations with LY.
Subscribe
to the YouTube page,
Larry Young Media.
Welcome back. LY Morning Podcast Show. And I'm happy to have with me Mr. Mark C. and Mr. Big E.
Mm-hmm.
And Mark, you done set me down.
Mm-hmm.
What did you capture today?
I don't know where it's coming through. Okay. Radio, we got an emergency.
Mark?
Yeah.
Okay. Had a little, the stations run the emergency code.
That's a good time for it. That's a good time for it, right?
So, now,
can y'all hear me?
Now we are back. You're back now. Thank you.
Okay. So what I was saying is, I just pulled it up. I said, Donald Trump says that he's going to run as a Republican for president because their voters are more stupid. This is what came up. Jared Kushner admitted Donald Trump lies to his base because he thinks they're stupid. Trump's son-in-law said he just knows Republicans are stupid, talking about Donald Trump, and they'll buy it, according to former New York Observer editor Maya Oppenheim. It says Wednesday, 31st May, 2017, and it says, Donald Trump lied to his Republican base and thought they were so stupid they would believe it, according to Jared Kushner. That's his son-in-law. Mr. Kushner, a property developer who is both President Trump's senior advisor and son-in-law at the time, reportedly made the remark after he was challenged about Mr. Trump's prolonged interrogation over whether Barack Obama was born in the USA. During Mr. Obama's 2008 presidential campaign and throughout his presidency, multiple theories emerged falsely claiming he was not a natural-born American U.S. citizen and it was therefore unconstitutional for him to become U.S. president. Mr. Trump was among those who pushed the birth of conspiracy theory and consistently questioned former President Obama's birthplace of Hawaii. The former New York Observer editor has now claimed that Mr. Kushner, the former publisher of the paper, informed her that Mr. Trump did not believe the birthers he was peddling. When I was the editor of New York Observer, Kushner and I were going back and forth about how the paper should cover him, Elizabeth Spears wrote in a post on Twitter. I told Jared that I was particularly appalled by his father-in-law's birtherism stance, which I viewed as cynical and racist. He rolled his eyes and said, he doesn't really believe it, Elizabeth. He just knows Republicans are stupid and they'll buy it.
Woo! And this has been out for several years, this statement?
Yeah. I just pulled it up on the phone. And you got it, Larry.
Okay. No, I'm just saying, I believe that. I'm just saying, here's a statement made like this by Trump, and yet his people are still supporting him.
Yeah, this came out while he was president. This came out.
Now, I understand. I got it, Mark. I got that. I'm just saying, for him to have made a statement like this, and yet his followers are sticking with him.
Yeah, it came out. It came out that he said that's why he ran as a Republican. That's why you know, Larry, that he hung with the Democrats and put money into their campaigns and the campaigns and all that. Donald Trump is an opportunist, and Larry, Mary Trump, his niece is back out again. She did an interview with a scathing interview with Lawrence O'Donnell, and I sent you that, and she called him a loser.
Gee.
One of the big reasons he lost in 2020, Big E, is because Mary Trump, his niece, who's a psychologist, came out and said he shouldn't be president. And his sister, they had the same mother and father, came out, said he shouldn't be president. He was the most dangerous man on the planet, she said, in 2020. And that he shouldn't be president. And both of them wrote books about it. And recently, Mary Trump has came out and she did it, you know, and I don't know, Larry, some audio with it. I send it to you on your phone and some audio with it. But, you know, she said the only reason his father wanted him to take over the empire wasn't because he was so savvy in real estate and stuff like that, but she knew that he was like paraphrasing a con man and stuff like that, and he could, you know, deal with the, you know, sell the public a bill of goods. And she said that he sold the empire when the father died, or when he at a loss. Check this out, Larry. $300 million. You know, so
you know Trump.
You've done your homework on this man. You've done your homework on him. Gee me, Moses.
I take it personal. I take it personal, man. It's no reason. You know, this tragedy that happened yesterday. When the difference in contrast between President Biden's response and his response when Big E, 3,000 lives was lost. 3,000 lives was lost.
You paper can't tells.
Say enough. Mm-hmm. In Puerto Rico during that terrible, terrible tragedy. And he went there with his heartless, coward self and threw literally three rolls of paper towels at those people. And we know why, because they were people of color.
They poisoning the blood. They poisoning the blood. Hey, Mark. You know, hey.
They criticized the mayor because she criticized him for the lack of response. 3,000 people. You can't say that enough.
Yeah. Hey, Mark, how do you think he would have handled this situation? Like, if he was in office right now, he probably wouldn't even care about us. He's Baltimore. Oh, that's a dirty city. They're rats and dirty people down there. We're not going to worry about them. The port is this, the port is that. So the way he handles stuff is just, he's not right for anything. He's not fit to do anything. Like I said, I wouldn't trust him doing anything for me. So if you stand with him, we know why you stand with him. You know what I mean? Because it ain't because of his policies and his and what he preached and what he practices. It's because you feel what he feel. And that's, you know, borderline, that's just racism, you know what I mean? You just feel superior and you are the chosen one, and everything you do is white is right, you know what I mean? It's all his agenda. His agenda is for his people, and you already know. So, look, we ain't with him. You know we ain't with him. One, I ain't with him. No way, shape, or form. Nothing. Nothing he can do for me.
His agenda is for Donald Trump. His agenda is not for his
exactly. people. Yep.
His agenda is for Donald Trump.
Or the rich
Trump
white man.
Right now. Mary Trump, MSNBC, Mary Trump calls Uncle Donald a loser as he faces gigantic legal tax.
Yeah,
see me, Moses. Did you say you had the audio?
Yeah, I don't. Let me see. Let me see, guys. It's not loud. I can't. It's not really loud, Larry.
Okay.
It's on your phone. Maybe you can put it up to the microphone or something.
Okay. No. Oh, that's all right. Well, your word's sufficient. I'm sure you paraphrased as close as you could. Wow.
Wait, let me see something, Larry. Okay. Here. Y'all go ahead and I'm going to see if I can. Here. Mary Trump, let me see. Okay. No, it's not loud enough.
All right. No worries.
Maybe during break, Larry, you can pull it up.
Maybe. Okay. All right.
Uh-huh.
Hey, when we play this little clip of Biden talking about what he's going to do for the bridge?
Yes.
I can play that one for you. All right. Let me
see. Go ahead. Thank you, brother.
We're going to send all the federal resources they need as we respond to this emergency. I mean, all the federal resources. And we're going to rebuild that port together. I've directed my team to move heaven and earth to reopen the port and rebuild the bridge as soon as humanly possible.
And that was it.
That's all right.
Okay, but look, I know Trump wouldn't have jumped on it like that. You think he would have made a statement for Baltimore like that? There's certain cities and certain towns he just don't like, and I know we one of them, so he definitely would have tried to, you know, push it to the side like the port ain't big business down here. Like the port ain't big business to the whole, you know what I mean?
Eric, you're so right.
I'm telling you. You know he is, because he's a racist. You know what I mean? Like you say, Puerto Rico, them certain, Haiti, all of, you know what I mean? He don't care. He don't care about the colored people or brown people or whatever you want to call us. Look, he don't care about us. So that's how I look at him. Look, and I don't care about him either. I don't care about his shoes, his politics. I don't care. I just want him to disappear. Right. If they could stop talking about him, I would be 100% happy. Like, just get him out the news, everything. Lock him up, do something. Just do something with him. Tired of hearing his voice, his name, his cane, everything about him just rubs me the wrong way. You know what I mean? Real talk. I really do. Because he's not for the people.
We're going to hear about him. We just have to expose. We have to continue
we gotta,
to do our
look,
part.
We got to keep him from getting in there. That's what we got to do.
You know, and the Democrats Dunn. Larry, I continue to be impressed with Dunn. And I forget his first name sometime, but the Capitol Police, and Larry, he was raised in Maryland. Harry Dunn, he's running for Congress, and I'm seeing
we put a call into him to have him come on the show, Mark. We haven't heard back from him.
Oh, well, I hope you do it, you know, some kind of way we can get him, because maybe Quasi can get him, because I want to see him out there, I told you. And I love the ads, man, because, again, Donald Trump, January 6th happened because he not only denied that the election was legitimate, But he also got mad at the vice president because he wouldn't, say that, and directed those people to go down there, and Harry Dunn was in there, and his commercials rightfully talk about it, Larry, like it should be talked about it, because they killed the police, they killed the officer, for one thing. Then you had officers, Big E, that committed suicide after that. They don't even talk about it was a black officer, and I can't even imagine how brave this man is. You had all those crazy people coming after him, and he just directed them away from Congress, where they was going to kill Nancy Pelosi and hang the vice president. They made where you hang people?
A noose.
No, they built a gallows. They literally built the gallows, man. They literally, and they said Donald Trump was at his house with watching on TV with his children and Glee, and ignoring the vice president calling for help. And his family was there. The vice president's family was there. And the one black man directed all of them away from the Congress so they wouldn't get murdered. And you still got Republicans saying there's nothing to see here. Am I right, Larry?
You're right. You're on point, partner. You're on point. Gee, me Moses. Well, Mark, what's going on in the city other than the tragedy we have been discussing?
Well, what's going on, man? You know, the reason, I started off by saying about the mayor, and I give him props. You know, I give him props, man, for doing what he's supposed to be doing, man. But, and I didn't see, and I don't know if you saw it, Larry, I didn't see the State of the City address, but the state of the city, as far as I'm concerned, safety-wise, is terrible.
Yes.
You know. Mm-hmm. But it says Baltimore Mayor Brandon Scott delivered his fourth State of the City address Monday evening. Scott was joined by city leaders at Baltimore Center Stage. He discussed investments in city youth, neighborhood development, public safety strategy, and vacant housing plans, among other topics. The address comes 7 weeks prior to Maryland's 24 primary elections, in which Scott is running for re-election. And what I don't agree with is, I know one thing he said was they did the first crime reduction plan or something like that ever in the history. And to be honest with you, man, I said something the other day. And I meant it, you know, one of the reasons that we need a change, is because of leadership. And let me start off with this. Number one, him and his city council president, they can't agree on a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. You know, one want more peanut butter, one want more jelly. And the reason I said that is because, like, let's just start from the beginning. When they first got elected, now mind you, Big E, they were on the city council together from 2011 to 2016, I believe. And I can't think of nothing that happened, you know, in that time. But anyway, so when Nick Mosby first became the city council president, he spent $700,000 for 9 more positions that the current city council president, who's now the mayor, said we didn't need. $700,000. So he keeps saying that I professionalized the council. I've been to city council meetings on safety and stuff like that. You know, and then you had the conduit deal. The conduit deal is huge. That for me, if I was going to vote for him, I wouldn't have voted for him because that's a deal breaker to me. The conduit deal, Nick Mosley says, you know, that, and he is. He's an engineer.
All right.
He said, don't do it. Don't do the conduit deal. And
Mark?
Mayor? Yeah.
Excuse me just a second, partner. We're going to put up State Senator Antonio Hayes. The legislature is in the final weeks. Great. And he has to break in when he can break in. So he's inserting us right now. So let's go to him, and we'll come right back to your point as soon as he finishes his update. All right?
Thank you, good buddy.
Okay. Let's go down to Annapolis right now as we go into the final weeks of the legislative session with State Senator Antonio Hayes. State Senator from the 40th District, Antonio Hayes, good morning, sir.
Good morning, Senator Young, and good morning to the family that's listening in. Thank you so much for having me. Once again, we have 13 days left in this legislative session, and things are well on their way. Before I proceed, Senator, I do want to acknowledge a big loss that we had in the individuals along the Francis Scott Key Bridge. We often refer to as the, you know, Key Bridge. My heart and prayers go out to those families and all of those who are really, you know, coming together to make things right as it relates to that. And so definitely want to acknowledge that. I think that has consumed a lot of the conversation here in Annapolis. I think it's, you know, way too early for us to know all that needs to happen, you know, coming up. But it was a great relief to hear from President Biden that the federal government and our congressional delegation is going to work to provide some relief to what's happened there. I think oftentimes we take for granted what actually happened at the port, but, you know, it's billions and billions of dollars. I think Senator Cardin estimated that each day it's a $15 million loss that the port is closed. And so tremendous, tremendous, you know, tragic incident that happened here in Maryland. In the final days of this upcoming session, we're still working on solidifying the budget. We've had the operating budget before us. I think the yesterday the House sent over their version. The Senate did not concur. And so, as you know, the operating budget will have to go to conference. We hope to have the capital budget before us tomorrow. But as I've said in previous appearances, there's a lot of disagreement between the House and the Senate. So I think this one is going to come down to the wire and where we actually land. But in the meantime, there's tons of pieces of legislation that are coming through this session. I think many of them are well prepared to hit the governor's desk in the near future as we wind down these next 13 days of this legislative session.
Wow. I know how it can be, and particularly, though, when you have the House leadership and the Senate leadership at odds, that makes that conference committee even more important.
Indeed, indeed. And you know, I think, you know, history has told us that it will work out in the end. It's just the uncertainty right now has everyone, you know, kind of on eggshells of where we will land. But at the end of the day, I have full confidence that, you know, the leaders of both of the financial committees as well as the leaders of both chambers will come together and do what's best on behalf of Marylanders.
Well, I respect your observations, good man. We all going to respect your observation. And it's good that most of the time here that the two presiding officers have been able to get along pretty much.
Yes. Yeah, no, absolutely.
So that's a major asset right there.
Indeed, indeed. And it's helpful that they're both from the Baltimore region. You know, I think that's helpful for Baltimore. And I think, you know, even in the governor's remarks in the light of the most recent tragedy, one of the things that he continued to say was Maryland tough and Baltimore strong. I think Baltimore is in a unique opportunity right now where we weren't kind of a priority in previous years. We've really stepped to a plate where, you know, leadership around the state is prioritizing Baltimore in a major way. And I think all of us will benefit from that as a result of it.
Absolutely. Do you expect the package on the juvenile side, services side, will be one of those hitting the governor's desk?
Yeah, I know the, yes, that will definitely hit the desk. There's still, you know, some slight differences in the House side versus the Senate side. I think that's coming to a close and about to be worked out. There's also some housing bills that linger out there. You know, it's challenging, you know, outside of Baltimore, where, you know, I oftentimes see a lot of the affordable housing concentrated inside the city. I think the governor made an attempt this year to make sure that, you know, all of the state had opportunities for affordable housing, especially, you know, some of the counties where their local governments have been more resistant, like in Carroll County and, you know, other places. Those bills are kind of stalled. Hopefully there's some resolution on them before we end session, or, you know, we'll come back next year. But I think, you know, definitely every place in the state should have the ability to have affordable housing and not price people, you know, out of the opportunity to live there. And so we'll continue to work through some of those issues. Also this year, you know, there's been some adjustments that's made to the, you know, cannabis industry. There's several workshops that's taken place. There's one that just took place last Friday at Coppin State University. 85% of the individuals that applied in a lottery, we finding out, are people that are, you know, Black, African-American. And so I think all of the work that's gone into that and making sure that folks who often were the subject of criminality as it relates to cannabis in our communities, all on the opposite end of that, have an opportunity where we have a growing, prosperous industry to participate as well. And so a lot of good results are coming of that. The young lady, and I think it might be a good idea, Senator, and I'll be more than glad to connect you. The young lady that's in charge of the social equity component of the cannabis industry is really doing a good job, because one of the things that people need to realize, not everyone will operate a grower or a processor, or not everyone will have a dispensary, but there's other auxiliary businesses out there that will require participation in the industry, whether it's security, whether it's delivery companies, whether it's, you know, all of the other things that help support the industry to survive. There's plenty of opportunities, especially for Black-owned businesses to participate in this growing industry. And so they're doing an awesome job of outreach and making sure that people are well aware of those opportunities and that they take advantage of and participate.
We would welcome having the opportunity to get a number, so we might invite her to join us on our show. Very much so, Senator. Please do.
Happy to make that connection.
Senator, what about bills that you have in the committee there, Finance Committee that you serve? Is there a particular bill that you would definitely want to see on the desk of the governor?
Ah, Finance, there's so many things that we have coming through this year. One bill that I championed and successfully got passed was the Access to Care Act. Many individuals that are undocumented immigrants don't have the opportunity to purchase health care here in our state. We passed that. Actually, I just got word that it just passed both houses, so that should be on the governor's desk actually this week, where individuals, now, because they're undocumented, they won't be able to get some of the tax credits that the rest of us enjoy, but they will have an opportunity to purchase at full price health care, which, you know, isn't the ideal situation, but because of their immigration status, if they choose to and if they have the wherewithal to pay for full price of health insurance, it's a big step in the right direction that will help alleviate or reduce the premiums for all of us. The more people that have health care, and one of the geniuses that, you know, President Obama did with the ACA was, the more people that are participating that are covered, the lower the costs are for everybody else. Because, you know, a lot of these individuals, especially, you know, and not just immigrant community, but people in our community that don't have the wherewithal, they use the emergency room as their primary source of health care. And so this is the opportunity that's opening it up for everybody to get more people insured, so we could, you know, cut down on some of the more chronic illnesses that lead to higher costs in the health care system.
Wow. Well, sir, 13 days to go, and Also, we'll be talking to you. We're now on from 4 to 5 daily on WOLB, and we're going to ask that after the session, I know you'll take a break or so, but we're going to keep you on, if you don't mind, to keep us informed as to what goes on, and we'll be asking you to do a legislative wrap-up when the session is over, but this time on WOLB, we're on from 4 to 5 every day, Monday through Friday. And so we want to make sure that you get that exposure as well so that our folks know what's happening in Annapolis. Senator Indeed. Antonio Hayes of the 40th District, thank you. Thank you so much, good man. And talk to you next week.
Talk to you next week.
Bye-bye. Peace now. Yes, sir. Well, fellas, we're going to take a little break. We're going to come right back, and we're going to continue. I'm looking at an article here that says, Scott says that Baltimore's strategy on crime is working.
Yeah, that stop me
Scott says that the Baltimore's strategy on crime is working. Mm-hmm. I want to know what y'all think about that. Mm-hmm. 410. Sorry, family. I'm giving you the right number. I'm used to that WOV number.
Give us
a call. 877-545-6643. Do you agree that Baltimore's strategy on crime is working? Mm-mm.
This segment of our program is proudly sponsored by STEM City USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, two organizations dedicated to fostering innovation and promoting excellence in STEM fields. At STEM City USA, they believe that there is an inventor, a scientist, a dreamer in all of us waiting to be discovered. They're committed to inspiring and empowering our youth by providing a platform where they can explore their interests in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Their mission is to create a world where every young mind is nurtured and their dreams are not just encouraged, but made possible. In conjunction with the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, they're honoring the best and brightest in the engineering field. This conference is a testament to the incredible talent and groundbreaking contributions made by Black engineers. It stands as a beacon of hope and a source of inspiration for future generations of engineers. Visit us at STEM City USA and become everything you are. Discover your potential, unlock your creativity, and let's shape the future together. Because at STEM City USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, we believe in you. Stay tuned for more of the Larry Young Show.
Okie dokie, back with us. Thank you much. This is the LY Morning Podcast Show. And right now we have a discussion. The mayor says, Mayor Scott, says that Baltimore's strategy on crime is working. And he made this statement, emphasizing his efforts to reduce crime, remediate the vacant properties, and maintain city services during his tenure, offering to build upon that if workers return him to office.
You're going to have him on the show, right?
He's been invited. Well, look, waiting for a response.
That'll tie right into the my No Stop Me Frisk, because we can talk about that when you get him on.
He spoke at Monday on Baltimore Center stage. He said his chief accomplishments was the holistic approach to fighting crime. And he stated that the city's homicide rate, which fell below 300 in 2023 for the first time in nearly a decade. This progress showcases that our strategy is working, he told several hundred people, including members of the city council. Now is the time to double down, not to pull back or return to the failed, broken policies of the past. Interesting. Mm-hmm. Now, what's your response to that, mister?
Well, you know what I'm going to say, because that ties right into the stop and frisk, and that was the reason that I was saying the stop and frisk, because the crime was out of control. So if he say it's working, maybe on nonviolent crimes, maybe, but for his gun crimes and shootings and murders, I can't say it 100% that it is. But like I say, look, if he come, Sheila come, whoever, I'm open. You know, I'm ready to have a discussion. I'm standing on everything I said. I'm ready. I'm ready and I'm willing. But I just don't believe it. You know what I mean? And just like them stats are stats. Like, you can manipulate the stats and make it look like 10 people or 10 less people got. You know, some of the stuff don't even make the news. Some of the stuff don't even make it. But with that being said, I just need more to be done. Just under that little 300 mark, that still ain't enough. I mean, we'll be celebrating. 299, 298, 290, we'll be celebrating. Still high. So I'm willing. I'm ready. Well, how about you, Mark?
So I got to say the Condor deal first.
Mm-hmm.
We got to talk about that because that affected all of us, and it will affect all of us. 70% of us, and Larry, jump in anytime you want to. 70% of us voted that we did not want anything done without Conduit, the underground conduit. We didn't want nothing done with it. Nick Mosby is an engineer. Him and the comptroller, Bill Hendry, they boycotted the meeting, the Board of Estimates meeting, because they were so adamant against it. Number one, this is not about Brandon Scott. It's about the office of the mayor. Anybody that was in that office, if 70% of your voters say they don't want something, then you don't do it. So whether they dangled $100 million in front of them or whatever, what's going to happen now, since he did the deal, is not only do they tear up the streets and all that stuff, the streets are terrible, but our gas and electric, and it's a done deal, is going to go up 3 years in a row, $400 million BG&E is going to collect from us in this three-year period. And so if they dangled $100 million or whatever, they're going to get that back, plus $400 million. So that's a deal breaker for me right there, you know. And Larry and I and Carlton Douglas stand by it. You know, Carlton Douglas said they sent a boy to do a man's job. But what it is, it's just terrible decisions, you know, that could have been made. Now, far as the lawlessness, because that's what it is. Number one, he was an intern in 07 when Sheila Dixon was mayor. In 07, Big E.
Mm-hmm.
And then from 2011 on up until he became the city council president, he was in the city council. So he know that's not true. The stop and frisk stopped with Sheila Dixon. She did the holistic, you know, and the consequences. And what she did is, and I'm going to tell you, Sergeant Hobson, 40-year veteran, my friend who died in 2020, co-host with me and stuff, he was a 40-year police officer. He said, Mark, he said this, not Mark. He said, Mark, Sheila Dixon knew what she was doing. She was no nonsense. She knew the police department. And not only that, Big E, this is what holistic looked like and collaboration. Some of our leaders that's out there right now, Tyrone Powers, Dr. Tyrone Powers, federal, that was FBI. He was on her team. Barry Powell, who's on Lunch with Label, was a retired officer and is a lawyer now. He was on her team. My friend and recovery brother, Brother Bay, who was murdered in a nursing home a couple years ago. And he worked with ex-offenders. He was on her team. Dr. Bunley, educator, who Pew put as the head of the African-American male engagement. Him and Captain Andrew, that's how We Out Us came, because Captain Andrew said it was too restricted within there, and that's how We Out Us came out in the street and all that kind of stuff. You know, so that's a lie. You know, right there. I just told you that. She created Safe Streets. And it was one organization, and she said it went political. Safe Streets is terrible right now. You got 12 locations, and, you know, you got a guy, Lauren, he came down to our safety meeting to try to disrupt it at the time. I mean, our youth forum, and he, 4 years, he was a supervisor, Big E, for Safe Streets, and he said that Safe Streets was terrible, that they wanted leadership, they didn't want to be the mayor over them no more, and he continued to keep talking about. And I always talked about expanding safe streets, but you needed oversight. And he kept throwing money, throwing money. Then come to find out, Larry, before when the FBI raided Bel Air Road, they found out, then it came out that some of the millions of dollars that he was giving to Rosenberg, I think the guy name was Rosenberg, that was head of Lifebridge, they wasn't even paying the rent and stuff like that. On the location, you have 12 locations where you could be young people could be able to go in there, get resources and all that kind of stuff. Then you had a young lady that came out and said that they would be at the McDonald's and she could clock in from there and stuff like that. But yet and still, you saying everything, we got, 400 carjackings last year, 11,000 car stealings, and it's even worse now. Just yesterday, guys, broad daylight, I believe it was, young people was chasing some young guy to carjack him and stuff like that. So it has to be a change because I don't know where he's, who he's listening to. I showed him the video. Me and him talk whenever I see him, I get a chance. I showed him that video of them young people attacking that man, leaving him in the street bloody and broad daylight and stuff like that. He wanted to know where it was. He was horrified. Giraldi was horrified. And we on the same path right now. The number one killer of our students is murder.
Mm-hmm.
You starting to see the dirt bikes out again. The lawlessness, when you don't address issues, they get worse. They're not getting no better. Mm-hmm. I never felt less safe in this city. And anybody they talk to say the same thing.
Hey, Muck, Sean, a quick question. He said about that BGE thing, is that affecting the counties and everything too? It's not just the city, it's everywhere in the whole Maryland? Or how that work?
I'm not sure. Sorry.
Is that going to affect everybody? It's for the city? Okay. Will it be the county too, Larry?
I know the water situation does, but I'm not so sure about the electricity.
Okay. Well, they don't care about the city. Sean, they don't care about the city, so they definitely don't care about the city. The county probably won't be affected, Sean. All right, go ahead, y'all can carry on.
That's why we're going to have a change, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
We are going to have a change because, the mayor's a nice guy and all that, but it's like the commercials say. The commercial was right on it, man. Because, when I'm the mayor, the buck stops with me. That's one thing I can say about the women. It's Women History Month. And we had three women mayors. Two of them got in trouble. But I can point to something that all three of them did that's going to have generations of that's going to help generations of our young people. And I can't point to nothing, right now that's happened under this, this leadership. Man.
So we're going to go with a no. We're going to go with a no on the crime working, right? Everybody on a no. No, right?
No.
Yeah, that's how I feel, no.
Well, we're going to have it up for discussion again this afternoon on the Larry Young In Conversation with LY. The question will be put up again. Scott says that Baltimore's strategy on crime is working.
Mm.
That'll be up for discussion. The coach will be on board,
mm-hmm.
and we'll have that discussion today. And from 4 to 5, please note that the show is on from 4 to 5, Monday through Friday. Let me take, before we get to, if we have time, take another topic. The update on the NAND conference. Well, family, I'm happy to report that we are 4 seats from being a sold-out bus.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to announce even now that we're going to do a second bus to New York on Friday, April the 12th. And due to the fact that we're able to get donors, Attorney Lewin Garrett, Attorney J. Wendell Gordon, and businessman John Batten, they have brought 16 tickets. So this is what I'm going to do. If you want to go, you can call the number that I'm going to give you right now, and you can get a ticket, and we'll give you one of their donated tickets.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to jump on that.
So it's a twofer.
Mm-hmm.
And you call after 11:30. Call after 11:30, and you call the number 667-910-1027. 667-910-1027. And if you buy a ticket, then by the way, the tickets are only $30 round trip to New York to go to the National Action Network 2024 National Conference in New York at the Sheraton Times Square Hotel. That's where all the activities will be. So if you are interested in going and you want to go, and think about it, $30 round trip, and you say, I don't want to go by myself. Well, I'll tell you what, you call us after 11:30, and the first 16 calls we get, we will be able to give each one of those persons a free ticket to go.
So,
But you got to purchase your ticket.
So some BOGO, buy one, get one.
There you go.
BOGO, y'all, buy one, get one. Buy one, get one.
So on the thank Attorney Lewin Garrett in particular, and J. Wendell Gordon, and then businessman John Batten,
mm-hmm.
who came with the idea of wanting to help out. And so that's what we need you to do.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do it, you'll enjoy yourself. The conference is major, a major conference. Believe you me, they got Whoopi Goldberg. They got Robert Smith, the black billionaire. They got 9 members of the Biden cabinet coming. And we're anticipating either Biden or Kamala Harris herself,
mm-hmm.
vice president, to be on hand. They won't announce that due to security reasons one way or the other. But we'll have one of maybe even both coming on separate days.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So what did you know about that? They're going to have one of my favorite talk shows, Morning Joe. The host of Morning Joe on MSNBC.
Wow.
He's invited him to come on. He's going to be on board. And Joy Reid, another MSNBC.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
She's coming. Yeah. So the lineup gets better and better every day. You listen to Reverend Sharpton, a show, and you'll find it. It's going to be a powerful, powerful program. And I'm encouraging you to take advantage of it yourself by coming and going up to New York with us. And we leave that morning and come back that evening. Just yesterday, I was talking to somebody, and I was telling them about, they said, now that makes it possible for me. I have to be to work Saturday morning. I said, well, we're coming back Friday night. Probably we leave New York by 5 o'clock. We should be back in Baltimore between 9:30 and 10 Friday. And that gives you a chance to go home, get yourself some sleep, get up and go to work Saturday if that's what you want to do. That's fine. And I even had one person say, well, I'm going to go up. I'm going to spend half my time at the conference, the other half shopping. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to know about that. I don't want to know about that. They were trying to be nice, but no, I don't want to know about that. You need to spend your time at the conference, but that's on you.
Mm-hmm.
Your money, you spend the time as you see fit. But okay, again, the number to call after 11:30, if you want to buy a ticket and get one free, so you have two tickets, as I say, a twofer, or buy one and get one free, is the number is 667-910-1027. 667-910-1027. All right, fellas, we got about another 6 minutes to go. Let me also give a shout out to I was reading something the other day that I want to commend Speaker Adrienne Jones. She was one of about, let me get over. Maryland House Speaker Adrienne Jones, Secretary of State Susan Lee, Comptroller Brooke Lieberman, Lieutenant Governor Arona Miller, and United States Representative Nancy Pelosi of California, born a Baltimorean, were inducted into the Maryland Women's Hall of Fame on Thursday. Since the hall was established in 1985, the Maryland Commission for Women has honored 4 to 8 women every year in March. And so the information I have in front of me here is that these 5 women were all recipients of being celebrating the Women's Leadership Honoring Maryland's First and Rising Leaders. Each woman chosen this year is a government leader and the first of her gender or race to hold her position. Jones, a delegate from Baltimore County, became the first Black and first female speaker in 2019. Lee is Maryland's first Asian American Secretary of State. And Lieberman is the first female controller. Miller is the first woman of color and first immigrant elected to statewide office in Maryland. Pelosi became this country's first female speaker of the House of Representatives in 2016. Whew. Each one of them are quite deserving. And working to get Delegate Adrian Jones with us real soon. Have her on board. So, yes, indeed. You know, I wish I had time to put together a women's list. Here we're going to the Women's Month. And I would have put some of our women, Joan Carter Conway, Shalonda Stokes, mm-hmm. Adrian Jones, and Kathy Pugh. I'm just thinking of some women that I was, my godmother, Helen Dale.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, yeah. Larry, real quick, and let me say, you brought up Kathy Pugh, and I talked about the 3 women mayors. Blake, what she did on her watch, it was 3,200 homeless students. She made lunch and breakfast free for all of the students. You used to have to fill out an application and all that. Pugh created the Office of African-American Male Engagement with Dr. Bundley and Captain Andrew because 99% of the young people that get killed is African-American. We had no office or nothing to deal with that.
Wow. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any big meetings coming up that we should know about, Mark?
I can't think of nothing right now, but you can go on weoutusmovement.org. Weoutusmovement.org and see everything that we're doing, that all the people that we collaborate with, what they're doing also. Right.
And you realize we have to get them on the show again.
Mm-hmm. Your
leadership.
You're doing the work, man. I told you, I was over Booker T the other day, even though they were going through Ramadan, can't eat, couldn't drink. They had the young people over there. And real quick, the subject was, what is a man? And one of the young people said, a man is responsible for his family and stuff. And then he said, how many words is in responsible? 2. Response and ability. Ability to respond to life issues.
Mm-hmm. Hey, how about them Orioles tomorrow, y'all? Y'all remember? Them Orioles tomorrow, right?
Uh-oh.
Got the Orioles, we got a little something. Got the Orioles, we ain't got the Orioles. We got the Orioles, look. We going on a game, y'all? What game we making to? I don't even got to do the first one, but I know I'm going with one of y'all. Somebody taking me down the game. Come on now. Larry, Mark, where we going?
I'm basketball. I'm basketball. When Sharon was working down there, it looked like some of them, the baseball players, was bored when they was out there.
Look, it's the atmosphere, though, Mark. Look, you go down there.
It's no more
boring. Atmosphere.
No more boring. The
and then we win it, too. And we win it. It's the atmosphere, though. You go down there, you know, get you a couple hot dogs, a couple little brews if you drink them, you know, get the you know, cheering with everybody. It's
the
atmosphere.
The Orioles,
you know,
are serious.
And we win it. So,
now.
Yeah, you know, look.
Yes, they are. I love my Orioles.
I'm going to be focused when we winning. You know what I mean? Look, when we wasn't winning, I might go down there, just party. But, you know, when we winning, yeah, we got a reason to go now. We got to go to one of
I love my Orioles. Oreos.
Don't you want to go on a year when we get this, when we get a World Series ring, when we get a pennant? Don't you want to go? Because we're going to get it.
Let's
go. Look, I'm rooting everybody. Let's do it.
Amen, amen.
I guess some Ravens on the next one. We ain't got too much of the Ravens talking about. You know, everybody know what's going on with them. We waiting. We working right now, but that'll be next week.
All right. Well, family, again, don't forget, after 11:30, you can give a call. Get rid of these tickets real fast. And, oh, by the way, also, somebody who gets a ticket, we're going to call, we'll win two tickets to see Diana Ross, who's going to be at the Lyric Theater on May the 12th. Wow. And somebody on the, will be able, including the first bus, we're going to be offering tickets for one of the people on the bus to win a pair of tickets to see Diana Ross at the Lyric Theater on May the 12th. That's also up for this giveaway. Mm-hmm. Okay, don't forget the number again to call in so that you might be able to get yourself a ticket or for TUFA, 667-910-1027. 667-910-1027. Don't forget to listen today from 4 to 5, Drive Time, to the In Conversation with LY and the Coach. That's today, every day, 4 to 5 on WOLB 1010 AM. Thank you very much, Brother Sean. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, MC, the Big C, Big E. And thank you and all for listening in, and look forward to hearing back from you. Also, I want to thank STEM City USA, as you'll hear in just a moment, for being a sponsor of the podcast.
Y'all brothers have a great day. Peace.
Rest in peace, Ms. Maybell.
Is proudly sponsored by STEM City USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, two organizations dedicated to fostering innovation and promoting excellence in STEM fields. At STEM City USA, they believe that there is an inventor, a scientist, a dreamer in all of us waiting to be discovered. They're committed to inspiring and empowering our youth by providing a platform where they can explore their interests in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Their mission is to create a world where every young mind is nurtured and their dreams are not just encouraged, but made possible. In conjunction with the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, they're honoring the best and brightest in the engineering field. This conference is a testament to the incredible talent and groundbreaking contributions made by Black engineers. It stands as a beacon of hope and a source of inspiration for future generations of engineers. Visit us at STEM City USA and become everything you are. Discover your potential, unlock your creativity, and let's shape the future together. Because at STEM City USA and the Black Engineer of the Year Conference, we believe in you. This segment of our program